here we will be seeing what's so special with aromatic compounds, how to know if a compound is aromatic, and how that influences their general reactivity, as well as some examples of specific reactions that follow that pattern. First, we have to make it very clear from the onset that the word aromatic is so different in organic chemistry as compared to the usual dictionary definition. Although aromatic usually refers to things or chemicals or molecules that have odor, usually a pleasant one, it's so much different in organic chemistry. And in fact, it's not even similar. It's not even close. So, it's so technical that in order for you to say that a compound is aromatic, we have three requirements. First, the organic compound must be cyclic. That means there is no organic compound that is non-cyclic that is aromatic. It is a strict requirement. That's why it's legitimate to call aromatic compounds as aromatic rings. Two, the organic compound must be planar, as in the planar that we clarified before about the geometry of sp2 atoms. In other words, every single one in terms of atoms in the ring must have an sp2 hybridization. And even if I have just one atom that does not follow it, then my compound does not follow this rule. And three, this is something that requires some kind of computation. This must follow the Hackel's rule. The Hackel's rule states that if I use the formula 4n plus 2 equals pi electrons, if I algebraically solve for the n, n must be a whole number, which includes 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. If you want to ask, what's so special about this formula? It's kind of complicated, and it requires a little bit of the molecular orbital theory. But since we're trying to avoid those technicalities, let's not talk about that in this recording. But that's what it is. I must have a value of a whole number upon solving this type of equation. And so, okay, before we proceed to the most common example of an aromatic compound, just want to let you guys see this one. I want to make it clear that other than having a double bond, another thing that can make a carbon or an atom sp2 hybridized is the possession of a charge. That means that carbocations, which are C+, and carbanions, which are C-, are also counted as sp2 atoms. So let's now see if benzene follows the three requirements. Anyway, benzene is most probably unanimously the most commonly known aromatic compound. So let's see if it follows the three requirements. Number one, is it cyclic? Of course it is. Two, is it planar? Well, let's see. This carbon has a double bond, so that's sp2. This one also. This one also. And if you extend it to all of the atoms in the ring, you have to say that all of them are planar. They have a double bond, so yeah. They are all sp2 atoms. And how about the Hackel's rule? Let's first identify the number of pi electrons. That's usually what we do. Okay? So you see that benzene here has three double bonds. And we already know that these bonds are what we call the pi bonds. But remember, those are pi bonds, not electrons. So remember that a bond is comprised of two electrons. So that means that we count this as like 2, 4, 6. So let's input that to the formula. 4n plus 2 is equal to 6. Then solve for n. That means I'm gonna have to transpose 2 to the other side. 4n equals 6 minus 2 equals 4. And to get n, I need to divide both sides by 4. And 4 divided by 4 is 1. Since 1 is a whole number, then that means that our benzene also passes the Hackel's rule. Since it is a check in all of those, then we have an aromatic compound. So again, if it's cyclic, it's planar, it follows 4n plus 2, it's called aromatic. There are some compounds that are actually called anti-aromatic. And again, the basis for the name is deeply rooted in molecular orbital theory. But long story short, if I have a compound that is cyclic, planar, and does not follow the Hockel's rule, usually when you solve for the n of anti-aromatic compounds, they are ones that have one half in their answer, they are anti-aromatic. If in the first place my compound is already not cyclic or not planar, or both not cyclic or planar, we don't even need to care about how many pi electrons it has. It is automatically called aliphatic, which is basically another word for saying non-aromatic. So what we're gonna do next is to assess the three examples below. I mean, five of them, I'm sorry. And know if they are any of, or if they are aromatic, anti-aromatic, or aliphatic. It can be any of those three. First, let's start with this one. Is it cyclic? So that's rule number one. Of course. Are all the carbons sp2? Well, all of them have double bonds, one double bond each, so yes. Three. How about the computation? How many pi electrons do we have? Well, I have here two pi bonds, and just like what you saw a while ago, we have to multiply that by two to get the electrons, so that's four. So 4n plus 2 equals 4 pi electrons for our example here. Then you can imagine 4 being subtracted with 2 because I transpose it. So 4n equals 4 minus 2, that's 2. And dividing both sides by 4, I get 2/4. Simplified, that would be 1/2. And since 1/2 is not a whole number, then it disobeys the Hockel's rule. And if you look here, then this pretty much meets the requirements of being called anti-aromatic. Okay? How about this example? Is it cyclic? Of course. Is it planar? These two have a double bond, so yeah, they are planar. These two, yes. And this one at the top, remember I told you a while ago that anything with a positive charge or a negative charge is also sp2, so yes. In fact, this one is completely planar. But if you solve for the 4n plus 2 formula, knowing that this also has 4 electrons, we know that, just like the example a while ago, when we solve for n, that will be 1/2, and therefore, it also fails the Hockel's rule. And in fact, we can also say that this example is anti-aromatic. But for this one, look at this. It's the next example is very much like the previous one, except that instead of a positive charge, I put a negative charge on this carbon. And that's going to make things a little bit interesting because the fact that I gave it electrons means that these electrons will participate inside the ring, or will be sent inside the ring, because the fact that this is adjacent to these two carbons, you should know that the localization is bound to happen. And that means that, let's go back to the first question. Is it cyclic? Yes. Is it all planar? Yes, because of the same reasons as the previous example. But now, the fact that I have two extra electrons, I don't have just four pi electrons now. I have 2, 4, and I add this, 6. And we already knew what the solution was a while ago when we had 4n plus 2 equals 6, right? This one. Yeah. The n is 1, and therefore, since 1 is a whole number, it passes all three requirements. Then we can say that this example is actually aromatic. Okay? This one, let's see. It's cyclic, of course. Planar? Yes, right? I have all double bonds here. Then the remaining carbon has a charge. And then, how about the 4n plus 2? How many are the pi electrons here? 2, 4, 6. And remember, positive means no electrons, so it doesn't add any 2 electrons. So 4n plus 2 equals 6. And just like a while ago, I'm sure that my solution here will be 1. And therefore, it also passes the Hockel's rule. And therefore, this is also aromatic. So hopefully you're getting a hang of assessing rings, whether they are aromatic or not. Finally, we have this one. First, is it cyclic? Of course it is. It's heterocyclic, but it's cyclic. Two, does this have complete planarity? Now, this is gonna be a little interesting because you might say no. And yeah, indeed, if you look at our heterocycle here as stationary, then it is not cyclic simply because this nitrogen has no double bond. But isn't it? So this is going to be a little review of our delocalization. The fact that I have a lone pair beside not just one, but two atoms that are sp2, doesn't that mean that this is going to move inside the ring and they are going to delocalize around? It's kind of similar to this example. Thus, the fact that you now expect that the lone pair will be given and that this nitrogen, if the electron pair is delocalized, will have a double bond means that it can actually be sp2. So in fact, this is also planar because of that explanation. And third, what's going to be our formula here? Didn't I just mention that this lone pair will be given to the ring? So since I have 4 originally and I add 2 more, that means 4n plus 2 equals 6, and we know that based on that my n is 1, and therefore it passes the Hockel's rule. And in fact, this heterocycle is aromatic. It passes all the 3 requirements. In fact, the reality is most of the popular aromatic compounds are aromatic, even if they don't look like aromatic in the first observation. Okay, so that's right. We didn't really have an example of a compound here that is aliphatic, but again, if a compound does not have complete planarity or is not even cyclic, then that's an example of an aliphatic compound. Like for example, this one is automatically not aromatic. It's automatically aliphatic since it's not a ring. Or for example, if I have your cyclohexane, then that is aliphatic also because all my carbons here are not even sp2. I mean, even if I add some sp2 atoms, if some atoms do not comply, then this is still aliphatic. Okay, that should be clear. Now, let's go to the general reactivities. Recall that if you were watching my discussions in proper sequence, the last videos were mostly about alkenes and alkynes, and the pattern was always like this. The fact that when I have originally a double bond, when I add a reagent AB, the double bond will lose its pi bond, and then AB will be added separately. And if you think of it like this, you can initially think of benzene as similar to that. Like, hey, doesn't benzene also have a double bond like this? And so maybe if I add AB, I would also do the same thing. Like, the double bond will become a single bond. And then A and B will be added both, right? But do you know the reason why aromaticity is a big deal? It's because aromaticity gives rings so much stability, okay? The clue was already the fact that since I need all my atoms sp2, you should imagine that, for example, in benzene, these pi electrons are resonating, circling around so fast, okay? Actually, not so fast. They are constantly distributed in that area that they are so stable, they don't want to give those electrons away. And so, actually, in experimentation, this reaction or this mechanism was not observed for benzene. It didn't give us a product with both A and B inserted to the ring. What happened was, when we added AB, first of all, the double bond stayed there. And that instead of both being added, it was only half of it, particularly the one which was positive. Which makes sense, because remember, if you're gonna be asked, is benzene nucleophilic or electrophilic? The fact that benzene has so many electrons in it, that means that it's, keyword, electron rich. And if you watch my introduction to organic reactions, you know that electron rich compounds are usually nucleophilic. And therefore, they're looking for something electron poor, which is this one. And you see that B was not part of the final product. It was found here missing. And of course, you might think, How is that possible? I mean, did I just add A without any consequence? And there is, actually. Remember, if you're going to be asked to look at benzene, you should realize that benzene has one hydrogen for every carbon, right? And in that case, of course, now all my carbons have four bonds each. In that case, what happened really was that from this carbon, initially it had a hydrogen. Later on, that hydrogen has been replaced by A. And guess what? Most likely, that hydrogen is going to be with B after the reaction, which makes sense because hydrogen is going to be on the losing side of the in the benzene ring. It's going to be more of electrophilic. And although, again, just like what I've been doing in our level of discussion, I don't really pay too much attention to the arrows, just to simplify things. The positive part here will match perfectly with the negative part here, giving us HB. And therefore, this is a substitution reaction. The fact that I just said A has replaced or, well, substituted for H. And since the one that substituted for the H is an electrophile, electron poor, then we can call the general reaction mechanism as electrophilic substitution. In fact, most textbooks even add another word to that. They really call it electrophilic aromatic substitution. Okay, but you know what? Despite the complexities of discussing the introduction, it's very, very simple. Because let me erase everything again. If your starting material is benzene, and your final material or product is benzene with an A, man, what did you just do? One, you just copied benzene. So like, that's so easy. You literally copy the exact same compound. And then from the reagent AB, find the electrophile. And usually it's the electron poor one. So this is the one you're looking for. And lastly, you just attach the electrophile to any carbon in the ring, knowing that in a ring like benzene, regardless of where you add the letter A here, it's gonna be the same. And this is very easy because you literally just stick whatever you think should be sticked or added to benzene and you're done. Unless you are being asked to indicate the byproduct, which normally is not really asked. Okay. Now, one last thing. I just mentioned a while ago that what's so special about aromaticity is stability. And indeed, benzene does not really normally react with most reagents. That is why, if you're gonna be finding ways to make benzene react, you need something to increase the energy, okay, actually decrease the activation energy. In short, speed up the reaction. I'm just saying that we often need catalysts for reactions of benzene. Given that benzene is so stable, you need a catalyst to make reactions happen in the first place. So next, I will be discussing specific reactions and the inner details of benzene that I think most entry-level organic chemistry courses discuss.